to another episode of Schmidt Lavelle. My name is Tom Lavelle, and as always, I'm accompanied by Mr. Timothy Schmidt. Double gun salute there. Look at you doing the double gun, the fingers. I like it. Thumbs up. Can I get a double thumbs up? Timmy just gave a double thumbs up, everybody. Wow. What a day. What a show. What a start. And we got a great show lined up for you today. But before we do that, we want to thank you for listening. We appreciate you. We love you. Coming along this ride we call Schmidt and Lavelle. And if you're not already doing it, give us that follow. Give us that subscribe. Follow us on YouTube. Follow us on Spotify, TikTok, Instagram, whatever it is. Follow us. Give us a little follow. We're trying to build up our followers. The more followers, the better content we can bring to you. Now, remember, if you want to be a part of the show, you can give us a call. It's 215-948-6546. 215-948-OK-GO. That's 215-948-6546. Give us a call. Give us a topic, something, a story, a funny little blurb, whatever it is you'd like to do. Leave us a message and we'll bring it up on the show. All right. Let's get to it. We got a lot of stuff to talk about, Timmy. And
we do?
Yeah, we do. We have a ton of stuff. In fact, let's get to our comments. We always start with our comments, and a lot of comments this past week on the videos we put out. Let's talk about the comments from our cell phone case video. We were at the bar and we were just talking, and Timmy noticed the gentleman next to him did not have a case on his cell phone. We were amazed that he did not have a case on his cell phone, only to find out that right across the bar, there was another gentleman with no case on their cell phone. And the other day I'm at the bar, I'm surrounded by three people, none of which had cell phones. We put it out there. Are we the crazy ones for having a case on our cell phone, or are they the nuts for not having a case? From Gerard Smith, there's serial killers, run. From Mev0598, you need a damn case. I literally ordered one for K Dolan 2 one Sunday when I realized he didn't have one. From S. Madden 10, no case? What kind of psychopaths are you associating yourself with? Absolutely need a case. Will Adler, somebody asked me to put my number in their phone without a case after I had just lotioned. Thought that thing was going to slide out of my hand onto the pavement. Yeah, because not only that, if you're asking someone else to handle your phone, it's like they're responsible now for you not having a case. From All City Schmitty, you must have the case. It's a must. Case closed. Suzanne Skin 112. Case for sure. I drop it all the time. From Bean DND. Cases are mid. From Jamie Dell 36. Case. I have trust issues. From Frank Wayne. Going raw feels so good. Caseless. The way God intended. From Sleepy T3. You must be rich. From That Eagles Kid. Cases overrated. Be careful and you're good. From Franklin Parnell, no case. Going raw out in the streets with my phone. LOL. From The Godfather and Meat, case for sure. Timmy, a lot of chatter about the case. I didn't think it was going to get this much chatter, but these people that don't have cases are psychopaths. I mean, I don't understand it.
I thought it wasn't a matter of if you had a case or not, I thought it would just be a matter of like what type of case you actually had on your phone. I think that's really the discussion. I thought that's where the discussion would head. I mean, this is nuts. This is something that's just unprecedented. Someone walk around, I can't even imagine not having a case on my phone. Can you imagine? Dude, I feel like I drop my phone almost on a daily basis, especially in the work that I do. Like, I'm getting in and out of trucks. I'm getting in and out of my car pretty much 15, 20 times a day. I mean, I'm in a store. I'm taking pictures. You know, I'm doing things like with my phone at all times. And if I didn't have a case on it, I mean, I would be running up bill after bill getting that screen fixed.
Yeah, even when I go to put it down with the case, like I put my phone down, okay, no big deal. You know what I mean? I can't put it down like I just did and kind of, you know, drop it there. Like with the case, it gives you the freedom to, if you drop it, if it falls, the accident, one little slip, and you said a couple hundred bucks. I mean, that's, these phones are $1,000. You know what I mean?
It's
case is $40. Yeah. Go order it on Amazon.
And I'll tell you what. I'll tell you what. That Eagles kid.
Uh-oh.
I got a bone to pick with you. He's sitting there. He's bragging about not having a case. Yet, you know, I've played golf with this man. And he has a nice little head cover on top of his driver. And as soon as he gets done with that driver, guess what happens? The head cover goes right on top.
Ah, a little hypocrisy there. A little bit of a, you know.
The guy wants to put a...
Maybe he doesn't care about the phone. He cares about the driver, though.
It doesn't make any sense. I mean, it really is mind-boggling. Dude, and, like, that's the one thing that really, like, freaks me out, right? So, when you drop your phone, Tom,
right,
there is that period of, like, 5 seconds when it's, like, face down, and you're looking at it, and you're just like, oh, my God, is this the time? I want to flip over that phone. It's got that nice case on it, but the screen's going to be cracked anyway. Like, that's the thing that, like, freaks me out. Like, I don't – that unknown, like, 5 seconds. And, like, and then you pick it up, you, like, take a deep breath, you flip it over real quick, and you look at it, you're like, wait a second. Is that the screen protector? Is that the actual phone? And then, you know, then you find out that it's not broken, and then it's just, like, all jubilation. You love it.
Yeah.
You've gotten by.
Money Tom, well spent.
Tom, I actually have the plan with T-Mobile where I have unlimited screen protectors. I go in there. If I break my screen protector, I go right into T-Mobile and I say, hey, I need this thing replaced right now because I'm not going a day without a screen protector. Not only a screen protector, a case.
There's a screen protector plan. I was not aware of that. What
unlimited,
an offer.
Unlimited.
That's a lot of protection, Tim.
Hey, you can't get enough protection. You people out there, stay safe with your
Not
phones.
Not in this world, Tim. You need all the protection you can get. All right, let's move on to our next video. A lot of comments on this one, and kind of something interesting happened. We put out a video. Well, I put out a video about Drake. And, Timmy, I guess I got to get your opinion on Drake and his music. But I'm not a huge fan. I never have been a fan of Drake. And then all this stuff coming out to light that he might, in fact, be a pedophile or something. I don't know. And a lot of accusations of him with the underaged women, I believe. I know he likes his songs in A minor, is that's what Kendrick Lamar said. Yeah. So I put this out that, hey, you know, the thing about Drake with me is his music sucks. I never really cared for him to begin with because I never liked his music. And a lot of comments from Nova A8798, very true. From David 113, yeah, well, that's just your opinion, man. From Aviator 4144, I can tell you don't know good music, LOL. I can understand not liking his music, sure. From PA Bucks, LOL. From King Starks 36, valid, LOL, and same. From Daddy Eugene, I just want to be different so bad. Give Take Care a single listen, and I promise you'll change your mind. Better yet, listen to literally any Drake album ever, besides Honestly Nevermind. And this is where it kind of gets interesting, Tim. From Mage Starts 76, millions of records sold say otherwise, but you're entitled to your opinion. And then a response from Jace XYZ. Millions of crackheads would tell you crack is great, LOL. It ain't mean shit. From a response back. You're so original, paraphrasing Tupac. Your post and your reply lack intellect and are clearly a cry for attention. A reply back from Jace XYZ. You got all that from a paraphrase. You're rather a psychic or projecting heavy. I think it's the latter. From Match Starts, learn what projecting meaning before using the word. Jake, projecting means to put your feelings into somebody else, much like how you said I'm crying for attention and lacking intellect. Drop your ego, bro. Your argument makes no sense. I paraphrased a famous quote, and that means I lack intellect. Please, make the connection for me. Timmy, wow, drama in the comments from my Drake post, huh? I've noticed one thing. Drake fans are still loyal. They still are protecting the Drake music. I feel like they're feeling a little guilty almost.
I thought these hoes ain't loyal. Isn't that a song by Drake?
I have no idea. These hoes ain't loyal. I don't know a ton of Drake songs. Like, you know, started from the bottom. Now we hear, I would hear all these dorks playing this in the bar, like pretending like they were this or that, you know, and it's like, enough. We've already heard this song 20 times tonight. I don't want to hear it anymore.
Yeah, I'm not into the old Drake Lamar thing. It's whatever.
I agree.
I mean, it's kind of over my head. I know it's people.
Are you a fan of Drake's music? Have you listened?
I do know that song. Take Care. I think it's pretty good. It's a pretty decent song. It's very upbeat. It's got a catchy little bite to it. You know. I think Trophies is a song of his.
Okay.
Which is it's like a good workout song. But like, I mean, it's most of his stuff, I think, is for the most part like up tempo, I think. I don't know. But look, I'm not like a deep cuts Drake or Lamar guy, dude. I mean, look at the two of us talking about something that we have no idea about.
We cover it all here on Schmidt and Lavelle. We really do. I mean, I was looking at, it just seems like when I did some research on this whole beef, seems like Drake was, you know, going after a lot of guys' girls. You know what I mean? And now there's accusations of him with the underage, with the young ladies. He likes them young.
I don't know if I buy any of this anymore because it seems like everyone's with a minor now. It's like every rapper is in the news about banging each other. What is going on right now?
What is happening in the rap community? Yes.
This is taking a strange turn. I mean, Michael Jackson was like the one guy I was like, all right, he's suspect. Okay.
Yeah.
He's the king of pop. I respected his music. The guy put out hit after hit after hit.
Right.
And then, like, I think we were clear of that for a little while. And now all of a sudden, like, all the pioneers in the game, Jay-Z.
Yeah.
Puff Daddy. P. Diddy.
Yeah. Like, now you got Meek Mill is in Usher and now Drake is like, what the hell is going on? What are we even doing here?
Everyone's diddying each other. It don't make any sense.
A lot of diddying going on out there. A lot of underage diddying going on out there. A lot of grooming diddying going on there. It's all very confusing, but I will say this. I never liked Drake's music. Timmy, let's get to our first call and our first real topic of the night. And this is one I think you're going to like.
Ooh.
Schmidt and Lavelle. This is consultant Chris. Tom knows me.
I do.
Family. Friend of the show. Longtime fan, first-time caller. Got to get some stuff off my chest. I'm in the car. Just left the hospital. Welcomed baby number 3 for my family yesterday.
Uh-huh.
So I'm in the midst of the hospital stay. And I've talked to Tom about this in the past, and it's getting to me because it's the third time and the last time, so I'm done with it, but I'm looking out for, you know, future fathers who are in the midst of this and have to go to the hospital. We got to figure out the chair that essentially is the bed, for the husband, the boyfriend, the father of the kid. It's goddamn ridiculous. I left the hospital today. I'm on the way to my chiropractor because my neck, I don't even know what's going on with it, but it's because of the chair. And the chair won the battle again. The chair bed won the battle again. Always does. And there's a lot of issues in our country, you know, politics, all the bullshit. The Sixers can't get past the second round, everything, but this issue with the chair has never come up as a national thing, and it needs to. So I'm just ranting. I'm just trying to figure out what we need to do, but I figure you guys might have some good ideas.
Timmy, are you familiar with this chair? You know, a father of 2, hospital. We'll put up a picture, but The chair needs to be talked about. It's the most uncomfortable thing ever. And I'm going to tell you this. After my last child was born, I'm telling you, for 6 months, my back was out of whack. 6 months after that. I was sitting there. And not only are you in there on the chair, a lot of times these nurses that come in to help, it's like you are, like they would not, they'd rather you not even there. You know, it's like I'm trying to help in any way I can or be at it. I have the baby, have this or that. And it's like, ugh, you know, this is all about the mom. This is all about the baby. You lay there in pain in a fetal position. And I'm not a tall guy. I can't fit on this thing, Timmy. You're what, 6'3"? There's no way you're on this chair. This is ridiculous. And at this point, I'd rather be giving birth.
I love the start of the call where he goes into, I'm on the way to the chiropractor from the hospital, which is great.
Yeah.
I love how he framed that. I love also the comparison between the world's problems. And he went from politics to the Sixers can't get out of the second round, and then into the chair when your wife or your significant other is giving birth.
Yes.
I'm going to say, how dare you? How dare you even question the comfort level of the man who isn't even giving birth to that child?
You're going the other side?
I mean,
Did you sleep on that chair?
Are we going to sit here and sit?
Did you sleep on the chair?
Yes, I slept on the chair.
You slept on the chair.
I got up to the chair. Hey, look, you got to suck it up, dude. Like, did you watch the birth? Did you get a 6-foot mirror put right in front of the person who's given birth to that child right in front of her vagina? Because I did, and I don't want to see it ever again.
Just see that chair? You see that unbelievable chair? Yeah. They might as well cut my back open and put a knife in there.
Dude, it is. Look,
we can do better. Can we not do better than that chair? Something that folds out a little bit more? I mean, even like getting it to put together is ridiculous.
Dude, I've slept in some worse places, dude. And I hear you. I hear you. The comfort level isn't really the greatest situation up there at the hospital. But, I mean, are we really going to get – we're going to sit here and we're
Tim,
really going to –
the world needs us. This isn't about the mom. Hey, look, they're covered. They're drugged up. They've got the, you know, zzz, zzz. They're going to be in pain. There's no getting around that.
I'll tell you what.
We could be a little more accommodating to the dad, don't you think?
Well, yeah, but I think I think we're missing the boat here, Tom. I think it's not about the comfort level. I think it's about the drug level. I think what's happening here. I think the mom, they get their nice little dose of
throw a couple muscle relaxers towards the dad, right?
I'm saying maybe a little Valium. Hit me with a Valium and let me sit in the chair and it'll be a little bit more comfortable than it actually feels.
It's not a terrible idea.
Yeah, I think it's just a slight alternative, right? Hey, yeah, the wife gets the shot right in the back. Maybe you give me a little shot right in the knee. You know, you split the shot. Okay. Whatever you don't want, give to me. And then I'll sit in the chair and I won't complain not a single word anymore.
Mm.
We'll deliver this baby together.
You know what? I feel like it's our responsibility. It's our campaign. We need to get better chairs in the hospital rooms for the doc, for the dads after that baby is born. I spent many a night in that chair, feet hanging on the ground, rolled up. It's like I might as well be sleeping on I probably should have just slept on the floor. On the floor.
How about that whole, like, speaking of like the delivery thing, like how about the OBGYN who, like, he goes through the whole pregnancy with you, right? He's you meet with him every week. He's into the whole thing. He's in your my ex-wife's vagina, checking it out all the time, right? And then it comes to time to deliver. The nurses do all the work. The dude gets called in like Jose Alvarado, and he's in there for like 20 seconds. Baby's bored. He's like, all right, I'm out of here. He goes off to lunch. Like, what the hell is that?
Yeah. I don't
It's
know
a
what, I mean, they don't seem to have a problem with it. I don't know. Like, why is it like that?
pretty
Interesting.
interesting. Pretty
Maybe I guess
solid.
there's just like a short window there of like, hey, expertise, bring him in, call in
Yeah.
the lefty, you know? Like,
It's
we need that guy. Bet you he has a nice chair to sleep, but we can't have that guy aching and in pain. Thank you
he's
for the
got
call there. What's that?
he's got to have a pager, right? The OBGYN. Like, he's probably the
Oh,
only dude in the world that still
a
has a pager.
pager. We
Like,
love a
beep,
good
beep, beep.
pager.
He's like, oh shit, I gotta get up to 14.
Hold on. Yep. I gotta go. Sorry. Good luck with the game. I gotta
All
leave.
right. I'll be back in 15.
All
Good
right,
call.
Timmy. This is gonna bring me to my next question and a bit of a pop quiz. Now I know you're a movie guy, and I just found this interesting the
Pop
other
quiz
day.
hot shot.
Pop quiz hotshot.
What movie?
Speed.
There you go.
Boom. Dennis Hopper.
There you go.
Boom. All right. So, great movie, by the way. Love that movie. Now, we were talking at the bar the other day. What are the best, worst movies of all time? And, you know, now that you mentioned Speed, I haven't seen it in a while, but it was a great movie, but it's probably so ridiculous to watch now. You know, the premise is the bus has to stay, what, above 50 miles per hour or else it blows up. And
It's
so,
like 55 miles an
yeah,
hour.
Keanu gets on. Either way, let me get to my question here, and it's a pop quiz hotshot. How old is Johnny Depp?
Johnny Depp. Dude, he was Edward Scissorhands. That was in, I'm saying he's probably Sixty-one.
He is 61 years old. I
Wow.
was blown away. Congratulations, Timmy. I was blown away, not to reference another great movie from the past, but I would believe that the audience out there at first thought would not think Johnny Depp is 61 years old.
Yeah.
You did the math there, you added it up, Edward Scissorhands, but I was like, 61 years old. How the hell is Johnny Depp 61 years old? I found it unbelievable,
Well,
Timmy.
Tom Cruise is, I believe, 61-ish too. He's right around that same area. And it's like, dude, all these actors that we grew up with are just older. They just
I
don't
guess
look
we're
older.
older too.
Yeah, they just but yeah, no, he's really fallen off though. He ever since the Pirates, he just, I mean, with the Amber Heard stuff, he just hasn't really been back at all, huh?
Yeah, like he did Pirates again and maybe a couple movies, then he had the Amber Heard stuff, but like he's 61. How much more can he, you know, like
I mean, De Niro's still doing the same character over for the last
De
25
Niro. What a
years.
disappointment. I loved De Niro and now it's like, okay, enough, buddy. All right,
You know,
let's get to our next caller. An interesting question and a topic, and I want to kind of get your thoughts on this, Timmy.
so reason for my call, the union announced that they signed a 14-year-old kid to a contract. Local kid, of course, which is a good thing, I suppose. But it got me thinking, with all these weird things going on with air quotes, amateur sports, the NIL, the transfer portal in college, is there such a thing anymore as amateur sports? I mean, for goodness sakes, how much money did Caitlin Clark already make? She was on every commercial in March, and good for her. Like, good on her. Transfer portal, it's killing college football, don't you think? I'm like, no one, all the stars are moving from team to team. The little schools, like, they're just bebopping around. And then the NIL, like, there's athletes in college now that are on full scholarships, are making hundreds of thousands of dollars, maybe millions, who knows? Like, is, I mean, we have professional athletes in the Olympics. Is there such a thing as amateur sports anymore? Is this a good thing? Like, thoughts? Timmy the Mush? Transplant Tom? Thoughts?
Timmy, so that call, he's asking about a 14-year-old that signed with the Philadelphia Union, a guy hit by the name Kevin Sullivan, and the highest homegrown contract in MLS history. Now, they've they're lending him to Manchester City, which is the top team in the English Premier League. They're going to win the league again this year if they win on Sunday. And it's just, you know, I like this kid's from Philadelphia. I like that signing. The question is, amateur sports still a thing? I mean, honestly, who cares? You know what I mean? Like, I think the NIL and all these deals have to, like, we have to shake this out and figure out how this is going to work in the game. I don't love, I kind of, as a young kid, enjoyed growing with players on a team and knowing the rosters a little bit better. But the NIL is still so young that I think it's got a lot of things that we need to tweak and figure out to where it makes it maybe a more enjoyable experience in that aspect. What do you think, Timmy? What are your thoughts on the question there?
There's still amateur sports. There's still youth sports. Not everyone that's 14 years old is getting offered a contract. I mean, if you think about it, let's stick with the same sport. I think it was Freddie Adu that was like 12 years old when he got his first contract, or 13 years old. He was supposed to be this phenom. Obviously never lived up to the hype, but I mean, that was, had to be 20 plus years ago. So it was happening back then. So did we question amateur sports then? I'm sure we probably overreacted. Is, you know, 13 too young to sign somebody? And look, if the kid has talent, I mean, why not get ahead of it, right? And if the kid's going to benefit from it and he's going to be well off and help his family out, Jesus Christ, like, why wouldn't you?
Yeah, you have to take the deal. Like, yeah. If you're, I never begrudge a player getting money, whether it's a bad deal for the team that I like or not. It's just the players got to get their money and help their families. And, you know, that can be some generational wealth there, you know, for them if they do it the right way.
So, I mean, but to what you're saying about, like,
I never had a passion for amateur sport. Like, the amateur title never, it never was something that meant anything to me, you know? I guess when I think about amateurs, I think, like, maybe the 1980, the Miracle on Ice, you know, and the Olympics back in the day, and then, I guess, college football. But I always thought the players should get paid, you know?
No, I agree with you. And, look, if we're going to sit here and ignore the fact that players have been getting paid for all these years, I mean, we're being
blind. Yeah. We're putting the thing over our eyes, seeing no evil.
Yeah. I mean, in 1990, I think it was two, there was a football movie that came out called The Program, where, you know, players were getting money from boosters, and that was in 1991 or 92, right? Joe Kane, like the
classic movie.
Classic film. And a movie was being, yeah, look, Varsity Blues, or not Varsity Blues, Blue Chips, right? With Nick Nolte. Like, all these movies came out about NCAA players getting paid to play sports. It's been happening for decades and decades and decades. And now there's an avenue for these players to make money. Even the guys that aren't even really the greatest, the best players in the sport, if they're going out and they're branding themselves and figuring out a way to make money, more power to you. And if you can do it in college, like, look, the NIL is the deal. It's name and in likeness, right? Those, that's exactly what it is, right? So if they're going to sell your jersey, right, like, they have to admit that, hey, look, number 35 is Tom Lavelle. He's our best player. Like, he should get money from it, right? Like, it's not like you can just sell that, like, that jersey is going to sell better because, let's say it's like Sean Conway. He might be the worst player on the team, right?
But,
and he's got number 34. 35 is going to sell a lot better because you're wearing it, Tom, right? Like,
and I have a case.
Yeah. So, right.
I always think of the Michigan team and all the money that they made for, I guess, the NCAA or college basketball or Michigan, and how popular that was back in the day, and them not getting a dime. I always think about that, you know, yeah. Like, these kids made so much money for that university and that sport, and just saw nothing, you know? Yeah.
It's a shame that it's not Because it is, I do agree that it is killing, it's killing college sports because of all the transfers, because players holding out for money. Like, dude, I mean, Deion Sanders is openly talking about recruiting out of the transfer pool because, you know, some of these guys are asking for, you know, millions of dollars to transfer over. It's crazy. It's like a free-for-all. It's like, imagine being in the NFL and at the end of every year, your team gets blown up and put in free agency. And then the teams essentially just bid on all these players. That's what's going on in college football and college basketball. Not so much baseball or anything like that, but you know,
and
brought
it's
up
such a large pool too, that it's hard. Like in the NFL, at least you have a limited number of players, so you can kind of keep better track, and then they have long-term deals and everything like that. The college pool is so big that it's like you get different players in and out, and it's hard to keep track. And I think it hurts with your fandom. You know, you don't love it as much because you're not connected with these players.
They're absolutely going to go where the money goes. And, you know, he talked about Caitlin Clark too. And like, she signed a deal with Nike, I think for like $32 million, right? Which is insane. But like, people wanted to complain about her making $76,000 in the WNBA. Oh my God, she's not getting paid enough. I mean, look at her now. She's making 20 or $32 million. Right, that's for an endorsements and all the other stuff. She's gonna change the game in WNBA. I think because of her, you're gonna see some of those salaries because people are starting to tune in a lot more to WNBA. I mean, there's people watching it on television. I had a buddy the other day who's like, "I think I'm watching WNBA. I don't know what's going on right now." And it's
I haven't
true.
Seen a game yet, but I want to actually.
Well, the season just started, so it's not like. But like, she's brought a lot more attention, a lot more eyes to that product, more than it's ever has. I mean, the women's college tournament was watched more than the men's college tournament this year. And that has a lot to do with all those stars in the women's college game. So we'll see.
Yeah, we'll see. Thank you for the call. And remember, if you want to give us a call, that's going to be 215-948-6546, 215-948-OK-GO. Give us a call. Leave us a message, topic, question, advice maybe you'd like to get, a story. Maybe you're just drunk and you want to ramble on. Give us a call. We'd love it. All right, Timmy. So I just got home from something interesting. I had a stress test done. Now, we've talked about in the past, I have this a calcium buildup in my heart. And so they want to do a stress test to see if there's any blockage. Okay. So your arteries are, they said it's like a tunnel, right? And say on the inside of the tunnel, you've got some buildup. Is it, you know, spread out where traffic can still get through, or is it blocking the traffic is basically how they described it. Everything went well. I don't want to give anyone any reason for concern. But it was very an interesting test. First of all, you have to do this test shirtless. You go there, you take the shirt off. They hook up the EKG to you, all the stickers with the wires,
all
running
the leads.
Through. Yeah, and then there's a lady there that they ultrasound where your heart is, and then they put you on a treadmill, and you go on the treadmill for about a dozen minutes or so. And then as soon as your heart rate gets to a certain point, you hop off the treadmill, you lay down, and they ultrasound you again and try to get all these pictures. Kind of an interesting thing. Now, first of all, I'm in there with an older lady, wonderful lady. She was talking, and then the ultrasound tech comes in, and they got you on this bed, and you're laying on your side. She's like hanging over me, like, do the thing, like, I'm like, so you from around here, or you know, like, what's going on? You know, I'm just laying there shirtless with this lady rubbing jelly all over my chest, you know. And then I get on the thing, and so immediately I tried, I'm like, man, I wish I would love to keep my heart rate down, you know, for a while and see how long I can go on this treadmill with, like, yeah, it's no problem at all. Turn up the speed a little bit here. You know, this is so they start you slow. It's like 1.7, and then they get you to 3.4, and then it's like 4 point something, and then it's 5.5, and they keep raising the incline. So eventually it's like pretty high up. And so it took me 12 minutes to get to the 155, I guess, beats per second, the heart rate. And I was trying, and they were very friendly. You know, they were boosting my ego. Oh, you must, you got a resting heart rate of an athlete, you know, 53 beats per second or per minute. I'm like, oh, you know, I've done a little bit. They get me on the treadmill, on the incline, and I'm going, and they're like, he's not even at 100 beats per minute. I'm like, well, yeah, there's no big deal. You know, I do this all the time. I walk the course every day.
I was about to say, you dickhead.
But it was just a very weird experience. But kudos to that. Like, they were so nice to me and so kind, and like basically were like cheering me on in this thing, which was pretty cool. You know, you've never had a stress test, have you, Tim?
I'm stress free, baby.
Well, once they get your heart rate up, they get you, they're like, get down, you got to lay down, and they're ultrasounding you and this and that. And they're like, hold your breath. And I'm like, Jesus Christ, I just was running on this thing now. Like, now I'm like, you know, I was running for
sounds pretty stressful.
It was. And I'm laying there and the heart's beating and I'm trying to like catch my breath and hold my breath. I'm like, man, I'm getting a little lightheaded here with this stuff. But all in all, they said everything went well. I'm waiting for the results of my test. And I feel good. I was on there. I passed the stress test. But if you ever have a stress test, you got to go to Penn Radnor, man. They take care of you, you know? As for Karen.
Yeah, tell them Schmidt Lavelle sent you.
Tell them Schmidt Lavelle sent you. But it is a weird thing on a treadmill in a room front of like three women just, you know, running on this treadmill. And they're like, oh, you're doing great. You know, like your grandmom there, like, oh, yeah, hey, you can have a cookie after this. You know, you haven't eaten and stuff like that. I was like, all right, sounds pretty good.
I got a treadmill story for you if you want to hear it.
I do want to hear it.
So my buddy tells this story. And he's scarred for life from the story. So he tells it as he said, so like I came home from football practice one day and he goes, I open the door and it's like, yeah, usually football after football practice, it's that signifies dinner. And he goes, I open up the door and he goes, I hear some pounding and it's tum. Tum, 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 tum. And he's like, it's coming from upstairs. He goes, the dinner's not ready. And he goes, there's a lot of pounding upstairs. So he's like, I started to investigate where the sound was coming from.
Oh,
and he
no.
goes, he goes, so I start to go up the stairs. And he goes, as I get closer and closer, I realize that the sound is coming from my mom's room. And it's normal because my mom has a treadmill in her.
Oh,
in
no.
Her, in her bedroom. So you know, he said he stripped down, he's up the steps and he's getting closer and closer to the bedroom and it's getting louder and louder, tum 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 tum. And he says he gets to the door, he opens up the door, his mom was running on the treadmill completely naked and his dad was on the bed giving it the old heave-ho.
Oh my god, you gotta lock the door, people. Lock the door. You don't know when your kid's coming home. What's going on here? Oh my god, that is traumatic.
It is
good for them though. That's pretty cool that mom and dad could get that going, huh? You know, God bless them.
That's quite the exercise there, huh?
Talk about a stress test. Oh man. All right, Timmy. Let's move on. And this will be our final topic of the evening. The other day, we're trying to figure out what movie to watch. We like to watch a movie at least Friday nights. We try to do movie nights with the kids. And, you know, throughout the years, we're starting to run thin on, okay, what's a classic that they haven't seen? And so We're going through. And I said, you know what? Have we ever seen the movie Annie? I was like, we've never watched Annie. It's a classic musical movie. You know, the sun will come out tomorrow. Very popular movie.
Your wife,
and
wait,
my
did you
wife
go?
said that she had never seen the movie as well. And I said, well, this is perfect. We'll put on Annie. My wife will like it. The kids will watch it. Maybe they'll like it. Maybe they won't. Whatever. So we put it on, and the movie's playing. And here comes a song from the orphanage. All the girls there, they start cleaning, and they go, it's a hard knock life for us. It's a hard knock life for us. And my wife goes, wait a second. Is this the original? And I said, no. No, Jay-Z is the original. This is the cover of the... Timmy, she had never heard or known that that song was from Annie.
Dude.
I guess my question to you is, every day now I'm seeing another song being covered, being talked about, redone. Last year's song of the year was Fast Car. You got a fast car. I got a ticket. Song of the year. What are your thoughts on these covers and these songs that the artists are putting out?
I do like the samples. Like when you sample some of the music and you're trying to figure out like where did I hear that from? Like, but they don't go full copy, right? Like it's just like they just sample part of the song, right? Like Jamie Foxx did that. I think he sampled Sam Cooke, right? In one of his songs where it's like, I can't even sing. I'm not even gonna try it.
Well, he did the Ray. He sampled Ray with Kanye. That song.
Right. That's what I'm talking about.
Gold
right.
Digger.
Yeah.
He gives me money when I'm in need. Yeah.
But he like that type of stuff is cool. When you go out and you just copy the song and basically sing it word for word, like there's no talent in that. Like, I mean, I love when people cover other people's songs, but to put it out there as like, and how does that win Song of the Year when it's like been already a song? I don't get that. Like,
Song
I
of
love,
the Year.
I love Luke Combs.
And he gave all the credit, like he did give a ton of credit to Tracy Chapman, I believe.
Well, who else are you going to give credit to?
Right, yeah. Like she should accept the award.
I don't like, oh yeah, like you, thank you for basically re-singing my song 30 years later. And it is, you just covered it basically. And now it's the song of the year. How does that even work? I don't get that. I mean, there's a song right now by Chris Young, who's a country artist or a country pop artist, as my buddy would say. He's like, it's not even country anymore, dude. It's country pop. Like, cut it out. Like,
AKA, it's better than what it used to be.
It's true. So it is. But he is right. I mean, it is completely
right.
Like,
it's pop
like,
music.
It's Q102 essentially, but when we grew up, except now there's a country flavor to it.
Right.
But Chris Young just, he basically sampled the entire beat of, it's the same beat as Rebel Rebel by David Bowie. And he just changed the word. He just changed the words. And I like Rebel Rebel. It's just now it's like a country version of Rebel Rebel. Right.
Right.
And then there's, what's the other one? Life is a Highway, right?
Yeah,
sung by Tom Cochrane, which I love. They love the original song. And then who came out with the same version? It's basically the same version. It's oh my
was
god,
was it a girl?
No, it's the country group.
What?
No, Life is a Highway.
Oh yeah, Rascal Flatts or something.
Rascal Flatts, that's who it was. And then like that became, I remember hearing it on the radio, and I'm like,
it was in the movie Cars.
Yeah. It's just like, dude, like there's so much music in the world today. I mean, I guess you can get away with like covering a song and then it just blowing up. Maybe that's how it happens. Like, oh, I'm just going to cover Fast Car. And then all of a sudden it blows up and it becomes the song of the year. Is that how it works?
I don't know, you know, and I'm hoping that the people that originally wrote and sang the song get their monetary, like, I hope they get money, like, a good chunk of the money that it's come, they should probably get majority of it. You know, I don't know how that works. You know, it's weird. Like I have heard some good covers that I like. And
one of the greatest covers that I've ever heard is Under Pressure, right? By The Used and My Chemical Romance. Have you ever heard that version?
No, I'll have to give it a listen because I love that. You're falling into my high school genre, dude.
Yeah, there you go. Very, very good cover there. I love that cover.
Ooh, maybe that's what something we'll talk about next week. Next week on the show, top five cover songs of all time. What do you think about that, Timmy? I'll give you a week to kind of to think about it.
You're going to get a lot of, like, because people love music. That's what,
yeah.
I love music. I said, Tom, when I become president, what I'm going to do, right. I'm not going to become president, obviously.
Okay. You got my vote.
But better than the other two.
I'm going to raise taxes, but let me tell you, it's going to be to a great jingle.
I wanted to put music on every corner, just speakers across the country, and just play music all the time. Outdoors.
I love it.
And just, hey, like, let's switch it up a little bit, right? Like, in different parts of the area, you know? Yeah, we'll play some country over there in Nashville, right? You head out to Compton, and you just get hardcore, like, West Coast rap, right?
Yeah.
Like, let's put everybody in a good mood, right?
I'm on board. You know what? Between that and the chairs, we're really coming along here on this show, Timmy. But let's do that. Next week, we're going to do the top five cover songs of all time. The top five songs that have been covered of all time. And I'm hoping we get, if you have a suggestion, leave us one in the comments or send us a message. We want to find the top five cover songs. Timmy, we got a week to do some homework, but I really think we could come up with some good ones. I'm interested to see your list of top five cover songs. That should be a good one. All right. That's going to bring us to the end of yet another episode of Schmidt and Lavelle. We love that you're listening. We love that you're following along with us. If you're not already doing it, give us that follow. Give us that subscribe. Tell your friends. Tell your family. Schmidt and Lavelle, the hottest growing show in all shows. Timmy, anything you got to say to all the Schmidt and Lavelle-ites out there before we sign off?
Yo, big shout out to the Philadelphia Phillies. 30-13, best record in baseball. What I tell you at the beginning of the year, no need to panic.
Let's go. Exciting to watch them right now. We love the Phillies. We'll be following them for the rest of the season. We hope you follow us for the rest of our season on this show. We appreciate you. We love you. Have a great weekend. Until next time, for Timothy Schmidt, my name's Tom Lavelle.
Peace.